Hey Ben, how's it going?
It's great. Good to speak to you.
Yes, I've been checking your transformation on Facebook. So you've come had quite a transformation in many ways since the law movement days.
Oh yeah, that's right. I've been through all kinds of changes, and I was just ch checking out your Instagram feed as well, and I see you're into a lot of body weight movement and handstands and functional fitness and that kind of thing, which is cool to see.
Yeah, well, it's a funny story behind that actually, because my father was a British amateur wrestling champion, and he spent a lot of time just having he went to Australia when he was 17, and he just had loads of free time on his hands because he was building things, and the income that he made from building things was extraordinary compared to the cost of living. So he'd work for 6 months and take another 6 months off, and he would fill that up with just doing things that he found interesting. So he had a wrestling background, so I guess he must have done more of that. But then he also did a lot of handstands. He could do the one-handed handstand and acrobatics as well. So
When you
he
say
did a lot of poking around.
building things, do you mean property?
No, he was he was a welder. And so he would build boats, planes, and trains.
Oh, I see, right.
But you know, but what he said is, he said that, you know, once the train is built, there's nothing more to do. There's no more ongoing work. You know, it's like you had an order for the train's built, that's the end of it, right? So you get like a good payout from whoever's buying the train or the boat or the plane or whatever it was. And that payout would allow him to live. I mean, I don't know, months and months and months and months on the income, and then when he ran out, he would get another job, build another thing, and have a lot more free time to just poke about in things that he found interesting. But yeah, it was a funny story actually, because I've always had this. I was doing BMX ramp riding as a youth. And that's really my passion. But you know, there's not a lot of BMX ramps around. You know, like you need a good ramp, and especially if you're traveling, it's not the kind of thing you can travel with.
So where are you
but
based,
and
Peter? Are you in Hawaii now?
what I'm in Bangkok at the moment.
Okay, so what's your lifestyle then? Do you move around?
Yeah. Well, I was. Well, I was teaching through live events. So when I was in London, I was doing teaching live events, teaching people about health at seminars, and I was probably doing about 2 2.5 days a week, you know, 2 evenings a week, and 2 evenings a week on average, and 1 day on a weekend. You know, but average it would be like about 16, 20 hours of teaching per week, and sort of 2 years ago, I quit all that because the bottleneck in my business is not live events. It's funneling people into those live events through communications, online marketing, and radio shows and all that lot. But also having a bunch of other things available for people other than just coming on live events. So we're working on, you know, product subscriptions, for example, consumable product subscriptions. And I'm working on a magazine at the moment as well. The website, we've got loads of stuff on the website, but the main page is just blank because we're overhauling that at the same time. So, you know, also got I've got a small book out and working, and I've got another 400-page book which is just about ready to print. So yeah, just taking. And the thing with the live events thing is that I kind of put off the whole communications and online thing for so long until I just couldn't, you know, just avoid it anymore. And that's because I just fundamentally don't enjoy sitting on my own all day long looking into a computer screen. That's not what I enjoy. I enjoy seeing people and moving about and making jokes. And you know, I get a buzz off you know, communicating with people. And so the whole solitary looking at a computer screen doing online jiggery pokery was never really my thing. And also, like, if it comes to book writing, it's the same thing. You're back on the bloody computer again. If it, you know, if it comes to video editing, same thing. I'm doing lots of video editing same thing. You know, you're back on Final Cut Pro on the computer again. You know, so yeah. Online marketing, emailing, you know, website building, the whole bloody lot. So I just basically avoided that for so many years until I just couldn't avoid it anymore.
Oh, I know what you mean. I totally understand. I mean, yeah, I don't know if you remember. Like back in the day when I used to do those online guitar lessons and stuff, and I spent too much time just sat at the computer. And exactly like you said, if you do too much internet marketing and emails, it's just you end up disappearing down the computer screen. You know, you got to live your life as well, haven't you? And so
it's a horrible existence, actually. I mean, I think I just really don't like. I just fundamentally don't enjoy that amount of time looking into a screen. I mean, a little bit is okay, but I mean, like, you know, like 40 hours a week, I just find that really hard to tackle. So, so eventually what I did is I've just got out of live events altogether so I can bring up the rest of my business into, you know, getting all the rest of the communications right, you know, in terms of, and there's some other things as well, like sales training for staff. Product manufacturing, offline stuff like magazines and books as well. So it's not just online stuff, but you know, there's a whole communication process so that everybody can get a little bit of the little bit of the magic, no matter where they are. And previously it was only the people that were willing to come to London. And so people in London, that was great. Anybody that was committed, they would fly from further afield, but you know, the numbers would drop off dramatically. And
I was going to say, what was the format of your events? Was it the raw food party, or did you do other stuff as well?
Well, it was funny, actually. So I moved to London shortly, I think just shortly in the year 2000, right? I was in Nottingham, left Nottingham in 2000, and I didn't know anybody in London. And I'd been at UPW, and there's this girl who I thought she was rather hot, and I thought she'd be good to date, right? But she just really wanted to get me in her network marketing.
Right, right.
So, and she was failing miserably because I got a job speaking to heads of international banks. So I was doing deals as a city slicker, and I was thinking, you know, and they were telling me about these products that you can, you know, like, I don't know, £20 here and £30 there. And I was doing deals for tens of thousands of quid with heads of international banks. And I just thought, what the fuck am I doing with this? You know, £20, I'm not going to mess around with that. So she gave me, she convinced me that I should meet her upline, which is Marcus de Maria.
Right.
And I still wasn't interested, but we met in Steve Oxlade's apartment, and because Marcus was sort of he was in between things at the time. He had this corporate job which he didn't want to do anymore. Then he was in debt and sleeping on his brother's floor for the best part of 2 years, and so he was looking to do something different. And then I still wasn't interested, but Marcus was just, you know, just a very gregarious, nice guy. And he said, well, you know, we have a personal development thing here every Friday night when you come along. And I thought, brilliant. I don't know a single soul in the whole of London. Brilliant. Great. Let's do it. So I started turning up to Steve Oxlade's, do you remember that? Leadership and Mastery Group. Do you remember that?
I remember Steve. I remember Marcus. I don't think I ever attended that group. No. Yes Group was my intro.
Yeah, it was a good one. So, you know, Steve was always going to Yes Group, and so was Marcus and me, and goodness knows, this was back in the early, you know, Pete Sayes and, you know, Martin Booth, still alive then. So this was, you know, in the early 2000s. And so it was the Yes Group, and then it was this Friday night meetup, which was kind of almost like a spin-off of the Yes Group, because there's a lot of people that we just met from the Yes Group, you know, people like Dave Becker and Angie Puglisi and etc., and Alex Pintea. So, and it was a really good group of individuals. And it got to 2005, and my newfound group of friends, they wanted to, they were very enthusiastic about doing better in life, and doing better in health, but they really didn't know what the bloody hell they were doing. And I grew up with health. I'd already been living and breathing health purely from a self-preservation perspective basically all my life. I really started studying health when I was 14.
Yeah.
You know, my father was a pioneer. I just went into the lounge and we had all the cutting edge health books from the 50s, 60s and 70s lying around the lounge. So I grew up with that. And I thought, well, you know, these people don't know what to do. I might as well show them what to do. So I put on an event called it the Raw Food Party. And I just thought it'd be a one-off thing. And then I'll be off on my merry way. And I wasn't sure what I would be doing with my career because I was either going to be directing big movies. That was one path I could take. Or at the time I was in financials as in the city, and I thought maybe I could do something in financials. And this was 2005, and it kind of seems a bit funny now because now if you look at the media environment, everybody's talking about health. It's all over the radio. It's all over the TV. It's in all the books. It's in all the magazines. You know, there's a million health videos on YouTube. But in 2005, it wasn't like that. In 2005, nobody wanted to know. If there was a single piece of media in an entire year that came out on health, it was either a Horizon program looking at the latest life extension science, or it was a front page newspaper sponsored by the pharmaceutical industry telling you how dangerous vitamin E was and dangerous vitamin C was, because they didn't want anybody to take that because then, you know, they wouldn't be buying as much drugs.
Yeah.
So back in 2005, I put on my one day event teaching 10 people what to do. And I thought that would be the end of that because I didn't think it was a business. I didn't think anyone would be interested in proactive health. You know, it certainly didn't look like that from the media environment. I just thought I had a bit of a weird, extreme niche hobby. And most people, you know, I mean, I know it's still the case today, but back then it really was the case. You know, people believed that their choices had nothing to do with how their health turned out. What they put in their mouth and how they exercised was nothing to do with, you know, whether they got cancer or heart attack or anything like that. And that if they did get cancer or heart attack, then they would go running crying to the mainstream medicine, and nobody else in the whole health sphere had anything relevant to say. You know, they didn't think, oh, maybe I need to do a bit of exercise. And that was it. So, but as it just kind of took off real quickly. And at the time, I'd left my City Slicker job, and I was actually helping Marcus get his stock investing thing going because he started to turn his financial situation around. I think he was about 70 grand in debt and sleeping on his brother's floor. And he kind of got this thing. He went to Wealth Mastery at Tony Robbins and really got excited about the stock market and sort of, you know, tried to get going in that. And he learned how to do a bit of some basic moves on the stock market. And then he thought he'd try and teach some people to do that. The only thing is he wasn't that great at the time, and he's good now, but I mean at the time he wasn't that great at sales and marketing thing, and I already knew him quite well by that stage. And he said, well, you know, why don't you help me do the sales and marketing for this project I've got? I mean, you know, people should learn this, and you know, help me with the sales and marketing. And I got fed up of doing the City Slicker routine, and so I said, all right then. So so I helped him out for a year, but then at the end of the year, that's when this whole health thing took off. And so then I called it a different thing, because over the years I came out with so many different courses and programs. It was like at the end it was like 30 days of non-repeating education that I would do delivering via seminars, you know. And it was a real seminar model,
right?
You know, you do your three-day seminar, which is an extremely low price point. And then during that 3 days, you give people unbelievable value. And then, you know, then you make your real money by selling them all sorts of other stuff.
So but, that was your seminar model, was it? You had sort of bigger,
yeah,
like sort of intro things and then bigger things.
Yeah, basically I was doing a three-hour free intro talk. And then from that would get them onto my 3 day seminar. And then at the 3 day seminar, then I would sell them everything else.
I see.
And that was a model that worked really, really, really well. And I had a little bit of guidance there, because when I first started speaking, I was just terrible. I mean, it wasn't that I was terrible. I knew my subject inside and out already. You know, I didn't need to know more about my subject. I was always a good student for health. It's just that the tools and abilities and skills of on stage speaking and persuasion, that was not something I knew about. And then I met up with Chris Howard, who I've always got a lot of love for that guy, because he was my first stage skills teacher, and he gave me so much sort of, you know, I just found him incredibly giving and incredibly
good
natured. Yeah, it was
Chris
just
Howard,
incredibly
just remind me, what was his deal? I'm trying to remember. I know the name.
Well, he was I think this is going back around about, I think, 2007. 2006, 2007. So
is
he
the guy
trained,
that does the big events?
He did huge events.
Oh, that guy, American guy.
Yes, he did huge events. So he was, people were talking about NLP still back in 2007. And I think it went on somebody's NLP presentation, and this guy was saying, oh, well, you know, yeah, you can learn NLP from me, and, you know, this is small groups and blah, blah, but, you know, this is going to be this bloody big thing on the weekend. I'm like, well, what's that then? And it turned out it was Chris Howard's thing, and it was free to go. Or, I don't know, nominal, like £20 or whatever it was. So anyway, I went there, and he had this massive audience, and his stage skills were unbelievable. And then I think on the Saturday night, he said, well, anybody that's got a message to share with people, and, you know, your trainers and coaches and blah, 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 then stick around. They've got a special session for you when everyone else goes. And this is all about how to present from stage. I thought, and he called it his platform and presentation skills program. And I can tell you something, man, that this learning the on-stage stage skills, I mean, man, that changed my life.
Yeah.
Because up until that point, I was persuading people one at a time over the telephone. And, you know, it was like quite a full-time job, just ringing around people, getting them, selling them one at a time. Then I learned stage skills and thought, like, fuck all that lot. And literally, I was on his, I think it was, I can't remember what he did. It was like a 7-day course or a 9-day course. And, you know, like the thing with a lot of these kind of personal development people is they like chanting a lot, but not doing that much with the information. Whereas for me, I was already speaking, and I thought, right. And it was quite an investment. It was more than £3,000 to go.
So this
on
is Chris Howard's public speaking course, is that right?
Yeah, platform and presentation skills, he called it.
Okay.
So it was more than £3,000 to go on it, and it was you know, it was like it was a lot of money for us at the time. So I just thought, well, you know, but I thought, I just felt good about it. I thought, well, this is the way forward anyway. So scraped the money together, and then organised some speaking gigs following the event. And I think literally we finished it on, I don't know, goodness knows whatever day, within days of finishing the platform and presentation skills training program, I had already got events with people coming lined up.
Right.
I thought, well, you know, I mean, but you, I mean, I've seen you say the same thing. You know, you get, you know, if you're going to do something, you have to, you know, you don't want to just talk about it. You know, you're going to learn a lot more if you actually do it. But the thing is, a lot of people, you know, they go on that kind of a program and they don't actually have a message. You know, it's like some of the skills from stage, but if you don't actually have a message,
yeah.
You know, there's got to be content. There's got to be real valuable content behind it. But I already had real valuable content. Mm. I just needed to learn about how to be, just a little bit more persuasive from stage. And because I was already a good salesperson, it's just that I was selling all sorts of shit to all sorts of people by that stage. You know, like, literally, I mean, I did everything in terms of sales you can imagine, from ringing up housewives at home to ringing up heads of international banks. I mean, and everything in between. So I had a lot of experience as a salesperson, but no experience from being on stage. And it was within 10 days of me finishing his course, I already made back all the money that I spent on it in additional sales.
Incredible.
So and thereafter, it just turned into this incredible life of freedom for me, where I basically worked 2 days a week, or 2 or 3 days a week doing presentations, and the rest of the time I had off.
Right.
To work on other aspects of my business, or go to the gym, or, you know, go out on a date, or, you know, do whatever the heck I wanted to do. It wasn't that I've never been lazy, but it just meant I had a lot of free time. So I had this beautiful house in Swiss Cottage, and there hangs some, you know, 6 foot trampoline in the house. Huge ceiling. Yeah. It was just like, it was a converted warehouse. So the ceiling was 2.5 stories from the ground floor. there's loads of headroom, and there's a mezzanine, and then I got into the gymnast thing, because like I was going to the gym, but I found out that, you know, like lifting really heavy weights, it's like where I was going wrong is I wasn't giving myself enough time to recover in between workouts. So next thing you know, I started giving myself more and more time to recover in between workouts. Like I was only having a workout maybe once every 8 or 9 days. Thing is, I'm used to doing a lot of exercise throughout my entire life, and I was getting really bored. So I was thinking, well, I better get myself a hobby. And, you know, there wasn't a good ramp to ride. So even though I got myself a BMX already, there wasn't a good ramp to ride. There was just a couple of skate parks like Camden. So I thought, well, I'll take up gymnastics, you know, it's funny because, I mean, you know, handstands, but, you know, like, you know, gymnast rings, this is not easy.
So with the warehouse, did you convert that place yourself, or did you move into
it? It was converted by property developers, but there was like, it was this massive great big warehouse, and they sort of, I mean, the thing was that, you needed serious work right before I got there. I mean, serious work. I mean, like, the only thing that they could actually keep was the walls. Everything else was falling apart, including the roof. Mm. but, I mean, they spent a lot of money on it. And then they divided the warehouse into, I think, 6 units. And I got one of the units. I mean, it's still fucking big. I mean, it was basically the size of a really, really good sort of 4-bedroom, 5-bedroom house, but instead of it being a 4-bedroom or 5-bedroom house, it was just all completely open from the floor to the apex of the roof. And there was, you know, just a mezzanine level with 2 bedrooms, and the rest of it was just this big empty cavernous volume. So I was hanging a couple of, as I said, 6 foot gym, the 6 foot trampoline on the inside of the house, and gymnast rings that was hanging from the rafters of the roof. So that was my play space. And then, when it was seminar time, pushed that aside and could fill up the room with 30 people.
Wow.
So, that worked out really, really, really well for many, many years, until, you know, I really got to the point where I wanted to have some different experiences of life. You know, I had a lot of time, and I had a good income doing something I love to do, and low stress income as well. I wasn't working a crazy amount of hours to earn the money to pay for it all. But, you know, the thing is, I was stuck with London, and that is as magnificent as London is, as compared to any city in the whole world. I lived there for 17 years.
Hmm.
And I think it was sooner, I think towards the end of that, you know, whenever, I think when the 4-hour work week, it got me thinking. You must have read that book, everyone's read that book.
Yeah.
But it got me thinking, and I thought, well, it's actually a really nice idea to try, living in different countries, not just go somewhere on a crazy holiday for a week or two and spending money, you know, like crazy, and then, you know, coming back and recovering from it. Mm. But, you know, just being somewhere for months at a time and engaging the culture. And so that implanted the idea in my mind. And it took me quite a lot of years to organize my business, so we didn't have all the money coming from seminars and enough money coming from other aspects of the business where I could have the freedom to work online. But so now it's kind of like, I still don't have the money. I still don't earn anywhere near the amount of money I used to do from live events, but then, you know, hey, Thailand's cheap, right? So, and it's, you know, I've got enough money to keep things ticking over whilst I'm building the online stuff up. But it's kind of interesting, you know, living in a different country, because it's just, you just have a completely different experience, you know, how people in a different country live and believe and think, and how they act can be completely different from London. And it's kind of fun to, you know, have a girlfriend who's a you know, different nationality and learn the language and learn to speak the language and eat their food and otherwise just live your, try and live your normal life as much as possible. So I go to the gym. And,
how long do you intend on staying there?
I tell you something. I just follow my heart. I don't like to overthink things because I think that I think there's some things that could do with a lot of thinking, like, you know, like tax planning, right? Or tax avoidance, for example. I worked in tax avoidance. That's good. Yeah, that's a good use of mental energy. You know, online marketing or strategies for moving your business forward or writing books, you know, and especially if you read a lot of my writing is very, have a tremendous amount of scientific references in there. That's hard going to write that kind of material. But, you know, so apart from that, I don't like to overthink things. And I think that as far as a lot of other things in life, I think following your heart is a really good thing. You know, it's like, you know, a friend of mine, she says it like this about relationships. She said, you know, just like you're either happy or you're not happy. You know, once you cut all the bullshit and all the overthinking and all the crap and stuff that's written about relationships and all that lot, the basis of it is, are you happy or are you not happy? And I think that some things can be, I think there's a lot of things which, I mean, okay, we're going to be talking about health shortly. Well, there's a lot of science behind the sort of studies that have been done to show actually what's going to work for human beings and what's not going to work for human beings. But I think when it comes to choices of hobbies and romantic partners and where do we get to live and what languages we want to learn and sporting endeavors, I think if you're heart focused and you just listen to your heart and ask yourself, well, you know, where do I feel happy? And last year I was in 8 different countries last year, and out of the whole lot I feel happiest in Bangkok. Right. I feel happy here. I feel happy. So I feel happier here than in anywhere else I could be in the planet right now. And that's not to say that, you know, there's a whole load of world that I haven't seen at all. Maybe there's somewhere else I could be even happier. Mm. But at the moment, I'm really, really happy. And it's a great experience to have different experiences. I mean, you know, you've got this real passion for hand balancing, right?
Yeah.
It's something that drives you. Well, you know, that's not logical, is it?
No.
there's something in your heart that says, yes, this is for me. This is the passion. And you've set your heart on certain things that you would like to accomplish within that. Mm-hmm. And I think you can have that same heart focus for quite a few different things in life. And it can work out really, really well.
Yeah, you know? I agree.
Some things it doesn't work really well. I mean, having a heart-focused finance plan. that's probably a really bad idea. You know, you need to be a bit more analytical for that. But I think, you know, I think that there's some things that really do lend itself. I mean, like having a, you know, like, I don't know if you ever come across this idea of having a checklist for a partner.
Well,
I don't know if you ever come across that.
Yeah, I've heard that idea. Yeah, tell us more.
I just think it's absolute. I think it's complete bollocks, isn't it?
Okay.
It's absolute bullshit. But all that you really want is you want to feel happy and loved, and that be reciprocated, right? You want to love someone. You want them to love you back, right? If you've got that checklist, you can screw it up and put it in the fireplace, can't you?
Right. So it's a checklist with one criteria essentially.
Well, I mean, you might have more than one criteria if you're thinking about making a family, because then, you know, maybe you're going to be a bit more thinking about, well, is this person a good father or could they be a good mother? You know, not just someone that, you know, because someone could be a good lover, but not necessarily, you know, what you might consider someone that you'd like to have children with. So, but yeah, I mean, you know, what did John Lennon say? All you need is love. But I think that I remember when I went to 7 years of art school, Ben, and I just left university, in 1996, and I was fucking terrible. I mean, I was so terrible. It was unbelievable. I didn't even know how to earn money. I didn't have a clue. I was just rotten. I didn't even know. I mean, being at art school, things like turning up to a job on time, that was a foreign concept to me. Mm. The amount of jobs that I got sacked from because I didn't turn up on time. You know, it's like, you know, I turn up 4 hours, 5 hours late. They say, what time do you call this? I look at my watch and tell them what the time is. And they say, well, what time are you going to come in tomorrow? I said, like, well, you know, maybe about, you know, 1 p.m. come in like 4:30. It's just like, what the fuck are you doing at 4:30? I said, well, you said you was going to be at 1 p.m. Yeah, but, you know, I was doing some reading and then I went to the gym and I ate some food and, you know, and now I'm here, right? I mean, I was terrible. I was bloody terrible. But then I kind of thought, well, you know, I was so in shit. It was unbelievable in 96, 97. And I thought that I'd better do something because I knew that none of the ideas in my brain that had anything to do with finance was worth shit. And if I didn't change my thinking, I'd be in for a real long, shitty ride in life. Mm. And that's when I kind of started coming into personal development material and marketing information and sales and persuasion stuff and the Nightingale Conan and all that kind of thing. Mm. And I thought, man, I need this shit so badly because the crap that's in my brain, that's seriously not going to work for me. Mm. So I was like a sponge. But, you know, I think back then I mean, 1997 was my worst fucking financial year ever. It was just so bleak. It was terrible. It was horrific. And, but, you know, and you kind of think that what's going to make you happy, and if you're not very happy and you don't have much money, you tend to think, well, if I had a lot of money, I'd be quite happy. Mm. But what I found is that, you know, you don't actually need a lot of money to be really, really happy. It's not that we shouldn't pursue a lot of money. I think that's a worthy endeavor. But I just think that, you know, we can live our something that we love to do. When you live your life, I mean, the two biggest changes that have made a difference, the two biggest things that have ever made a difference to my happiness levels is being in love with a woman that loves me back and doing what I love to do as far as a vocation.
Yeah.
You have those two things going on, it's fucking happy.
Yeah, right. The money just facilitates.
You're really, 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 really happy. And, you know, and then the thing, and I remember I went on, do you remember George Zambatas?
No, I don't.
Oh man, he was organizing these. I don't know. This was in the, I think, the late 2000s. Okay, the mid to late 2000s. It was a crazy fucking good time for the seminar industry. Mm. It was bloody good. Everyone was making so much money. It was a joke. It was crazy good. And I mean, even the recession didn't even, you know, slowed it down a bit. But I mean, people were still spending loads. And so he organized, I guess he'd made friends with Simon Woodruff. Okay. And before you know it, and so Simon Woodruff, he was the first dragon on Dragon's Den. Right. And before you know it, there was the whole crew, right? It was Duncan Bannatyne that came along. Then there was Simon Woodruff. And Simon Woodruff was really fun. Duncan Bannatyne was just really dry in comparison. It was just like, it's really funny. But then he got all sorts of, he got the Michelle Monaghan, who did the, Wonder Bra, and then there was Richard, don't know his surname, but he founded Innocent Smoothies. Okay. Anyway, so you got all these guys speaking, and it's like, you know, they're going to have a millionaire mind weekend. It's like, you know, get all these successful self-made entrepreneurs, and we're going to, you know, talk about, you know, building something that's actually meaningful. And I remember there was this guy, and we were hanging around Richard from Innocent Smoothies. And he was just standing around, and there was like four or five of us thinking we should ask him some questions. And this guy that was near me, and he asked Richard, he said, well, what do you think about pursuing something for money? You know, even if you don't like it that much, what about just going after the money? And Richard said, I think it's a really bloody bad idea, because if you pursue something, you know, just for the money, and you don't inherently love it, what if you don't make the money? Mm. I mean, if you don't make the money, but you still love it, you still had a happy existence.
Yeah.
All right, maybe you're out of the money, but you've still had a happy existence. I think, you know, James Dyson is an example of that. He pursued his dream for a long period of time. And he had a lot of financial hardship, but he pursued his dream.
Did he?
You know, for vacuum cleaners, right?
What do you mean hardship?
Oh, do you not know the story of James Dyson?
No.
Oh, he was right royally fucked over.
Really?
Yeah. People stole his designs and everything. I mean, you got to remember, I don't know if you remember, but, you know, back in the days of the Hot Point Hoover, you know, before Dyson came along, you know, vacuum cleaners were the most bloody boring, utilitarian, ugly thing you can imagine. Yeah. I mean, they were really fucking ugly. They were disgusting to look at, right? And the only reason why anybody bought them is because there wasn't anything else that could suck the crap out of your carpet.
Yeah.
So, and the thing is, and how he got his business started is I think someone ripped him off, I don't think it was a big brand as well. I think it's a big brand. It might have been Hot Point. I don't know. Someone, you can read the story, but someone ripped him off and he sued them, and he got enough money from the payoff of the lawsuit to start production.
Oh, I see.
But, you know, and then you contrast that to a friend of mine because, you know, I mean, like the whole London thing, you know, there's always this thing, you know, like, oh, yeah, property, get involved with property. And, you know, there's all these groups that, you know, oh, property, property, property. And so a friend of mine, he got busy with that and thinking, oh, man, if just, you know, get into property and make all the money and be, you know. And the thing is, that's great if that's what you love to do. It's just that he hated it. And the thing is, he spent 9 years in property hating every minute of it, and not only did he hate every minute of it, in addition he didn't actually make any money for 9 years. And you think, well, you know, a British man is scheduled by the Office of National Statistics to live to the age of 77, right? And let's imagine the first 20 years of your life you're so distracted with all the bullshit the government and the school teachers and your parents tell you, you're not even listening to yourself and what you're interested in. Well, yeah, and the last 3 or 4 years of your life, you just run over with diseases and decrepitude and kidney dialysis. It's not really going to be worth living. So really, you got between the ages of 20 and maybe 73, so you've got 53 years to live your magic, right? As a man, average man, okay? I want to be a bit better than average, right? But average man. Well, if you've got 53 years to live your magic, you spend almost 20% of that doing something you hate.
Yeah.
That's a fucking high price, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a really high price.
Yeah.
To spend 20% of your adult productive life doing something you hate. Now, in the end, it actually worked out for this chap because I know some change in the marketplace and all these properties ended up paying him, and then he ended up with quite a lot of, quite a lot of financial freedom and flexibility to go around the world pursuing all sorts of things that was interesting to him. But 5 years of just complete shit.
Right.
9 years of just complete shit. I agree with Richard. Do something you love to do and figure out a way to monetize it. And, along the way, whilst you're figuring out how to earn a fortune from it, you're still happy because you're doing something that you inherently enjoy.
Makes sense to me.
I think that when you have those heart-centered, some aspects of your life can be very heart-centered. I don't think business decisions necessarily should always be that heart-centered and, you know, finance things. But, accounts planning, certainly not. But I think some aspects of your life can be working out really, really well. But, yeah, this year I've been in Bangkok for, 10 weeks, 9, 10 weeks already. I can speak pretty good Thai. And then I'll just be tripping around Asia a little bit. I'm going to go to Manila next month, probably go to Japan. Life's pretty good when you've got an online income and a passport.
Yeah, right.
You're a very mentally developed guy Ben, so, you know, you also hang out with also interesting people. So, you know, I mean, you must have your own thoughts on a lot of this stuff as well. But, you know, I just think that, you know, really what makes life interesting is having a variety of different experiences. And if you keep on doing the same experience all the time, then you don't feel as if you've lived that much. You feel as if you've, I mean, like, you know, like imagine the office worker, you know, and they say to their boss, "Hey, boss, I want a promotion." You know, and the boss says, "Well, you know, why do you want a promotion?" Says, "Well, I've got 10 years worth of experience." The boss says, "No, you haven't had 10 years worth of experience. You've had 1 year of experience and you repeated it 10 times."
Yeah.
You know? And that's not just true of work. It can be true of relationships. It could be true of where you live. And my mum, she left Holland in her early, I think mid-20s with a couple of Dutch girls, and Australia was just, man, they were just trying, they were doing everything possible to bring people over to Australia to try and build the country up, because it was just like, you know, a massive great big rock with nothing on it. That was basically it.
Right.
and so the Australian government was sponsoring Europeans to come over, and so my dad got on a boat for £5. You know, you pay Australian government £5, get on a boat in Europe, and they take care of you, literally all your food, drink, boat, fucking everything, you know, accommodation when you get there, until you can sort yourself out and get yourself, you know, work. My mum, she paid double that, because she went, I think, about 15 years later, she paid £10. So, but, you know, I mean, this was 50s and 70s, but, you know, it was 60s, but, I mean, it's still, it was, you know, it wasn't a lot, £10, in relation to, you know, the cost of a boat trip. And my mum was always regaling these wonderful stories of how she had this incredible experience for the 4 years she lived in Australia. And towards the end of that, she met my father and they got married and they came back to Europe. And so she was there four years. And she's still regaling those stories about, you know, this happened and that happened. And but she said she was moving around so much, you know, so much variety in her life. She fancied a little bit of stability. So she was kind of praying for, you know, just staying in one spot. And then so she came to London, and then soon after London, she went to Peterborough, and they lived and they moved in the first house. Which is a really nice house on the edge of a forest, and they've stayed in the same house for the last 46 years. And I was with my mum last summer, and I said to her, I said, you know, a lot of conversations we had, and I said, yeah, because I spent a few months with my mum, and I said, "Mum, I think you lived more in those 4 years that you was in Australia than you have done in the whole 46 years that you've been in this house combined." And she said, "I think you're right." And you know, why would someone believe that or agree with that? And I think it's because, you know, we feel as if we've lived, if we have different experiences, if we have the same experience, you know, it doesn't really register as living if we do too much of the same thing.
Mm. I'm curious to ask you about the tax benefits of being abroad. And I know you said you had a financial background in banking and stuff. And you, so, like, is there anything you can say about that?
Yeah. you know, there is... I think it was Robert Kiyosaki who said it best, and that is that you know, you kind of think that taxation is a jail, but it's just a jail cell where you've got the key, and you know, when you realize it's the jail cell that you've got the key, then, you know, it becomes a choice. I mean, there's so many things you can do, you know, to circumvent things. And, you know, the bigger the companies, the better they are at doing it. You know, the wealthier people, they're really, really good at minimizing minimizing expenses, and the biggest expense for most people is going to be taxation. You know, it's not to say, oh, you don't have to pay taxation. Of course you have to pay tax, because you know, there's VAT and everything, isn't there? So you're not going to avoid tax, but there is just a plethora of choices which you can do to minimize it. And that's not my skill set. My skill set is in health, but you know, I know enough about that to minimize my liabilities. And I think this is something which makes sense. You know, I think, yeah, when I've researched it, Ben, I think that the two biggest expenses that anybody ever gets in their entire life is taxation and the cost of poor health. I was recently making some videos. We have a product which is incredible, and it has a lot of science behind it, where it really, really would dramatically reduce the chances of anybody getting dementia. I mean, dramatically. You know, so much scientific studies behind the individual ingredients we put in this product. So I was looking at that recently, and I found out this unbelievable story, and that is that one out of every three people in Great Britain gets dementia if they live to the age of 90. Some people don't, but yeah, if they live to 90, one out of three. And when you get dementia, 70% of all dementias are Parkinson's, which is completely uncurable. The care bill for looking after someone with dementia, from the national UK average, is £30,000 per year. But if you're in the home counties, that's £1,200 a week. So what's that like? £60,000 a year, £70,000 a year. And then I started looking at, I think, the Alzheimer's Society, and they said, well, here's the deal. When you get dementia, well, you know the NHS is, you know, stuffed. They can't make ends meet financially. The government doesn't really like spending money unnecessarily. So what happens to that £30,000 plus care bill? Well, at the moment in Great Britain, this is what's happening. The government pays £10,000 a year, and you pay the rest of it, which is starting at £20,000 a year. So, you know, that's most of what the average person earns.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I kind of heard from a long time ago that, you know, if you want to kind of, for most people, it's easier for them to save money than it is to make money.
Yeah.
And in which case, then the two biggest bills that you face, taxation and cost of poor health, it's worth your while, given it some energy, isn't it?
The health or the taxation, or both?
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to go into more detail about the Alzheimer's thing? You were alluding to, you like some nutritional method that helps it. What did you?
Yeah, mean? Yeah. I mean, you know, the thing is this. I've never worked as a scientist, I've got an affinity for reading science, which is. It's. I mean, I don't know if you've ever read scientific papers, but I mean, they use a style of language which is very impenetrable, and difficult for any lay person to understand, and really dry.
Yeah.
But I've got quite an affinity to read that kind of thing, and I actually quite enjoy reading science papers. So a lot of what I've done is that you kind of get in health, you get the, you know, the sort of the cheerleader types, which I think is, you know, people like Tony Robbins. And I mean, like, brilliant at psychology, but in health, that's not his specialty. So he's a cheerleader as far as health is concerned. Jason Vale, for example, and they have extremely simplistic messages, which can help people. You know, go, you know, stop eating shit and eat some fruit and veg. And I mean, I don't know if you've done a UPW, and then they say, "I'll do the 10-day challenge, eat nothing with a face." Mm. But you know, and this is basically where I started in 2005. And the thing is, that message, it doesn't really solve a lot of problems that people get into. I mean, people come to me with every kind of problem you can imagine. I mean, you name the problem, I've pretty much had it. I mean, it's, you know, 2,000 people and plus another 7,000 or so that have been on my seminars but didn't pay. They just came in a free seminar. I mean, you come across every single problem known to man pretty much. And, you know, when people – and the more dire the problem, the more they actually need a solution which is going to work for them. Well, that you know, and you know, 10 press-ups and eat some apples – 10 press-ups and an apple a day. Hmm. You know that's too much of a that's not enough of a solution, especially the more dire the health problem. And so what I've done across sort of the last, well, all my life really, because I started reading health information at the age of 14, but I mean, what I really in some ways I think of myself as a translator. I get the health science, which is very difficult to understand. It's difficult to read. It's got its own unique language, a bit like legalese. Nobody knows what the fuck is going on unless you're one of them. And, you know, like I've had students of mine saying, "Oh, what about I come to like a health conference with you?" And it's not that I dissuade them. I just say, well, you know, good luck. You know, good luck. It was just like, just good luck with just being able to understand what people are saying. And I remember one of my students came one time. It was a good one in London, a big one in London. And after a while, I said, "Well, I ain't getting on." She said, "Well, I kind of understand about 50% of what they're saying." Mm. And she was a really, really, really enthusiastic health reader. It's the same, the vernacular of health science is a whole vernacular in and of itself. So I've just very much seen myself as, in many ways, as being almost like a translator to get that information and put it into and communicate that in a way to people that's going to move them emotionally, where they understand it and they're going to move them, it's going to move them emotionally. Yeah. So, you know, the kind of language that would get a layperson to understand something which can be quite complex and get to move emotionally, this is not a language that scientists are capable of. I mean, I've been to science conferences. I mean, like, literally, you get these guys that are just brilliant at what they do, but, they, you know, they're wearing a lab coat and they come out of the lab. I mean, people skills and communication skills, they didn't get those genes. Yeah. And, you know, I've seen professional audiences give them a rounding, you know, a big round of applause at the end of their 30-minute presentation, not because they've done such a good job, just because they're so happy that they're getting this person off the stage.
Yeah.
So, because, you know, like, even professional audiences, some of these people, you know, they're such anoraks, even they don't know what the fuck is going on. They don't know what they're saying. So yet alone a lay person. So, yeah, so what I've seen is, okay, so people want some real solutions. They're going to want some solutions that are actually going to work for them. And, you know, the real simplistic cheerleader-style message of a Jason Bell or Tony Robbins is not enough. The health science is so convoluted that they find that unpenetratable, and it is, for practically everyone. And, you know, so I've been one of the lone voices getting that information out in a way that people can understand and get moved by it. So yeah, they get some pretty good results. But you know, when I get people to do things, it's not like I just, you know, I hate all this woo woo wah wah stuff. You know, I just think that if somebody wants a result, you need to identify the top five things which are likely to work for you, and crack on with that first before you mess around with anything else.
So what's your own diet then, Peter?
My diet is not that dissimilar to the diet that is that a lot of people in the life extension longevity movement have arrived at. So at the moment, the life extension longevity movement is a rather niche group, and it's dominated with hardcore scientists and really lay people, or not, you know, the language is not the right language for them. That's starting to they're starting to change, but essentially what people have concluded is that the diet for the human being that's going to cause us to live a long time disease free is very much a plant-based diet with some seafood. Now, I'm always a big advocate for, and I think that if you put yourself out there as somebody that can help people, well, first off, I mean, it just stands to reason. It doesn't matter what kind of thing you want to learn or become good at. You've got to get someone that's capable of doing it themselves.
What do you mean, your clients? How do you mean? Or do you
Well,
mean the
yeah, I mean, you
teacher
know, the
needs to
thing.
be an example?
I mean, if you're going to learn something, you want to get a teacher that can do it themselves,
Oh,
don't
the
you? You don't
teacher,
want
right.
someone that's full of shit. And the thing is, like, for example, you know, you get professors at universities. I remember I met this girl at a nightclub, and we hit it off right there and then in the nightclub. And, you know, along the way, it's like, well, what do you do? Well, I teach health. And what do you do? She said, oh, I'm a nutrition student at I'm at King's. Well, all right. So I said, well, I'll tell you what I would do is if, you know, when I'm master of all universes and all galaxies, I would basically I get all these professors and I tell them they all take their shirts off and based upon the way they look, I decide which ones are allowed to stay. And she said, well, that wouldn't work out very well. I said, why is that? She said, they're all really fat.
Yeah.
You know, and so you think, how the fucking hell does a fat nutritionist convince the dean of the school that they know what they're talking about?
Yeah.
It's a joke. It's a bloody joke. It's outrageous. You know, and so and I mean, this is not just true in health, it's true in other professions as well. I you know, one of my first jobs is working with financial advisors when I left university, and soon after that I started working with business people, and then I found like started working with these business people, and they said, well, you know what happens when we get IFAs? We say, well, you know, I'll tell you what we'll do. You show me your bank account, I'll show you my bank account, and if your bank account is bigger than my bank account, then we'll have an appointment.
Yeah, it's not gonna
That's
happen, is it?
how you get rid of 99% of all these fuckers trying to come with an investment proposal and the IFAs.
Yeah.
That's it. They never come. You know, I've seen I when I was working with IFAs, I've seen grown men cry because they couldn't keep up with their Porsche payments. It was like fucking odd. And I was working at the top IFA firm in the country at the time. Jay Rothschild. That was the number one. That was the prestigious one. It was bloody hard to get into that. If you weren't that good, you'd have to work at some other lousy firm.
Yeah.
It was just hilarious. But you know, it's like you know, and I just think that we should be. If I mean, I've always tried to do what I would want. If you do something, you know, when I write a book, I write the book that I would like to read. When I do a seminar, I make a seminar that I would like to go to. When I was in my student's shoes, when I become a teacher, I tell them what I would want as a teacher. You know, I wouldn't want a fucking fat health teacher. Can't sort themselves out. Don't know their ass from their elbow.
Yeah.
You know, I'll tell you something, Ben. This is going to happen. I am going to start the world's most stringent health qualification. And why it's going to be so stringent is because if a student can't sort themselves out, they don't qualify. You know, if they can't get their blood pressure under control, if they can't get their body fat under control, and whatever crazy other health problems they've got. But I mean, body fat and blood pressure is just basics, you know. And then we can start talking about atherosclerosis, which kills most people with heart attacks and strokes. If they can't get it under control, you're not passing the fucking exam. That's it. You're fucking fat. See you in a year.
Yeah.
You got hypertension. see you in a year. And yet we've got this health qualification model, which comes from our universities and our hospitals and medical schools, where they're qualifying all sorts of people, not just that, nutrition colleges as well. They're qualifying all sorts of people that can't even fucking sort themselves out.
Yeah.
And then you've got, the lay public who've got, all right, well, you've got, you know, put fruits and vegetables for a juicer, Jason Vale style message, impenetrable science that nobody can understand message. And they think, oh, well, I better go to someone that can decode some of this stuff. And they end up with these so-called health professionals, which are qualified. And they, I mean, if, I don't know, I'll tell you what, if you want to get, type into Google, Chris Van Tulleken topless.
Okay.
It is not good. Skinny fat.
Right.
Is what we're talking about. You know, the guy's skinny fat, right? And you know, like, why is this a problem? Because if you're fat, Oxford University did a study of the biggest big fat study on fat people ever. It was like close. It was nearly a million people. And they found that if you're fat, you're going to die anywhere between 2 years and 10 years earlier than slim people. That's just how it is, right? Fat kills people young. No two ways about it. They die quick, and they die of everything nasty quick. They get a lot more strokes. They get a lot more cancer. They get a lot more heart attacks. They get a lot more diabetes. You name it. If you're fat, you get it all 10 years earlier than everybody else, right? So we know that fat is a problem, and then the whole skinny thing is a problem as well, because if you don't have adequate bone strength and muscle strength, one out of every two women is getting a bone fracture.
Right.
And one out of every four men is getting a bone fracture. Well, when we start talking about hip fractures, 20%, one out of every five women that gets a hip fracture, she gets so depressed from that and her inability to live her life as she used to, she dies in the next 12 months because she quits the will to live.
Mm.
So, you know, it's like, you know, as I say, the Peter Pure School of Nutrition, you can't sort out your bone density, we're taking your license off you.
Right, right.
You know, and the thing is, you know, and then you get that fucking, who is it, the fat Chinese guy on British TV, Giles, I don't know his surname, I don't know, I'm watching, but, you know, he's fat. He's supposed to be an obesity expert. Yes, he's an obesity expert. He knows how to get fat. He's on British TV.
So yeah. Tell us about the books then, Peter. How many have you written, and you've got a new one coming out?
Yeah, well, it's a bit of an orchestrated plan that needs to happen, because there's many different things that all need to come together at the same time. But the first book was a salad recipe book, 100 salads. That was really easy to do. It's out of print now. Okay. Second book was a book that I wrote for my students that I could give it to their irresponsible friends and family members. So it was called Health: 7 Deadly Sins. And it was literally a little tiny book, 75 pages, really fun language. I think there was about 9 pages of cartoons and 220 scientific references in the book as well. And I put that in there because even though the cartoons and the way I speak makes the understandings incredibly easy to learn and incredibly digestible. On the other hand, you know, I like to read science dominated material. That's what I really like. I hate reading stuff where they don't have any science references behind it, because I think, well, these people are full of shit. You know, it's like, you know, people come with real health problems. They don't want to know that the solution is tree hugging, you know. If it is tree hugging, I mean, nothing wrong with tree hugging. I mean, I could fall in love with being a tree hugger. I mean, I grew up on the edge of the forest. I love trees. Thing is that really going to work for most health predicaments? I don't think it is. You know, if you've got cancer, you know, hugging a tree is not the place to start. So, you know, and the thing is that, yeah, it's natural, but is it going to work? And that's really where a lot of disconnect is with I just guess lay public population right now, and that is that they kind of got the idea they don't want to do the surgical thing. They got the idea they don't want to do the pharmaceutical thing. They're looking for what's supposedly alternative solutions, which are safe and not toxic. And I've got one more criteria: does it actually work? because if you're pursuing something that's safe and non-toxic, but it doesn't work, you're barking up the wrong tree.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are doing that. They really are. I mean, you know, the lay public, they are so misguided. It is unbelievable, the silly shit that they do, thinking that it's gonna cause them to heal. Somebody's got to be putting them straight. I've taken it upon myself to do that. So yeah, the second book was a little book, 75 pages, 220 scientific references in there. So if anyone wants to check out what I'm saying, I've given them all the links to all the science journals and whatnot. They can read the studies that I'm basing my ideas on. And then the next book is the Bible number one, I guess it is. It's called The Incredible Self-Healing You. It's a 6x9-inch book. It's currently hitting up about 400 pages. It's all done, actually. All I need to do is hit the print button. It's just that I want to get a few other aspects of my communications in check before I release that. Because, you know, a book like that, that's a good calling card to get onto radio shows. Mm. You know, you have a really, really good book and you can be a radio show guest. I met Dr. Barry Sears. He came to a life extension conference and he was talking about inflammatory processes in the body. And a friend of mine, it was actually Richard Lippmann. He was the inventor of the nicotine patch. So he did rather well with that one. A lot of nicotine patches got sold. Well, I know the guy who invented it, Richard Lippmann. And anyway, so I was hanging with Richard and Barry Sears had yet to get on stage. So Barry Sears, he's quite well known in the US. He's the author of what's known as the Zone Diet.
Okay.
Well, the Zone Diet, it was never an idea that kicked off in Great Britain. And Barry get to get on stage with his inflammatory message. And I was hanging with Richard, and Richard's saying, hey, you know, there's Barry Sears over there. And, you know, he's done rather well. He's sold 10 million books.
Jesus.
And I thought, well, 10 million books, you know, if we just make a dollar a book, you're ahead of the game. Uh-huh. If you make more than a dollar a book, you're doing really damn well, aren't you?
Yeah.
So he finished his presentation, and you know the rest of the audience, they all had these science questions and inflammatory-based questions, and you know all sorts of health shit that they wanted to ask him. I was right up there. I was not guy number one. The first question I said, "How did you sell 10 million books?" And he said, "Well, actually, start off with I wrote the book, and it didn't go nowhere. It went nowhere. It went absolutely nowhere. But then I did a drive time. I think it was West Coast USA radio show, and it really went bonkers from there. And I already knew that would be the case because I was hanging with it was a guy, a former talk show radio host from West Coast." And he came to London teaching people about how to communicate on the radio. And I did his course. And I found out that radio is here to stay because if you're driving, it's the only type of media you can digest whilst you're driving.
Yeah.
You can't digest any other. Okay, billboards maybe. But, I mean, other than that, it's the one type of media you can digest whilst you're driving. So if you've got a message and you can speak English, well, there's 60 million people in Great Britain. There's people secondly speak English in a lot of countries around the world, but the big one is North America, right? A third of a billion people up there.
Right.
So you can't avoid, if you've got a message in English, forget about the Brits, you're after the North American market.
Mm.
And there, you're going to get those people whilst they're in the car by getting on the radio. That's right. How you sell a shitload of books. And as you know, I don't know if you've done much research into books, but the book is the catalogue for your business that they never throw away because people feel as if the book is, you know, something of value. You know,
yeah.
They see it in a different light than a brochure or a magazine. So people tend to be a bit more precious about books. And so a book is a great, you know, if you kind of think where I used to be with the whole seminar business and structure where you do a free talk. Well, there the book model is your free talk is prime time radio.
Mm.
Big stations, right? that's your free talk. All right, what's your super cheap 3-day event, you know, the equivalent of T.R. Eker's Millionaire Mind, you know, where you just get people just to pay a nominal amount of money just to make sure that, you know, that they're actually still breathing, you know, and that they're likely to turn up. But it's a book.
Yeah.
It's a book, you know, it's a $10 book, it's a $15 book, right? You keep the price point low. And then you make your real money at the back end.
How does it work with publishing? I don't know. I've never released a book. So what's the situation with that?
With publishing?
Yeah.
It's changed. Well, I mean, it's changed a lot. I think we're in an interesting crossroads. I think we're at an interesting crossroads of information distribution, and you see this most prominently in the music business. I mean, you know, if I remember, like, as a boy, you know, you go to the shops, and I don't know if you're old enough. I'm 46, but I mean, we still had 7-inch records.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, and you go to the shops and you get the latest single that was on Top of the Pops and on a 7-inch record. But you know, I remember seeing I think it was NME magazine or something like that, and the amount of bloody people that had their hand out on part of that gravy train in between the artist and the shop selling you the music, man, it was fucking people all over the place, right?
Yeah.
It's not quite so many in the book business, but it's about the same. It's not really that changed that much. But then you see with music artists that actually you can sidestep all that lot, create your own website, upload your own digital music, forget about the pressing plants and the distribution and the shops and all that shit, and just sell your files directly to the end customer and keep the profits, right? And so the only thing that you need there is a vehicle to drive lead generation. Well, a radio show is the perfect vehicle to drive lead generation.
So you've published it yourself, and did you print it yourself? Yeah. Is that what you mean? Right.
Yeah. Print it yourself. You know, the thing is, I mean, if you, I don't know if you're thinking about doing a book, but or what your message is, or how big your message is, but is that. How you make money at books, you either become a shit hot novelist. I mean, J.K. Rowling does all right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or you use a book as a catalogue for your business, and it's the byproduct of that which is where you make your real money. So do you remember a guy called J. Conrad Leveson?
I don't know that name.
Yeah, you know, he was, I mean, this was going back before the internet, and he was the original guerrilla marketer. He was the guy that said, you know, fuck the Coca-Cola sales advertising campaign. That's not what we do as small businesses. We need to do things in our business which is going to result in money. You know, we don't have the budgets of, you know, Coca-Cola and the likes. So he wrote a whole series of books on guerrilla marketing, you know, the small medium enterprise business people could do to drive business. And anyway, so he wrote a whole series of books, and what he said is that, well, you know, the books made him, like, I don't know, goodness knows, a few hundred thousand dollars or whatever from the book sales.
Yeah.
But the consequences of getting those books out there, you know, the business that came off it earned him multi-millions. Mm-hmm. So you make your money, and back end. You know the back end.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
Books are catalogued. Where's your back end? So what I'm doing right now is I'm building out my communication process on back end. I did the book already. You know, I've got two books already. You know, I mean, the thing is, if you give someone a 400-page, 6x9-inch, you know, most people aren't going to read that unless they're really convinced already. But, you know, that's for the people that are already, you know, the true believers out there, right? They've already come to the Church of Peter Pure. But, you know, the people that are the lucky lose, you know, they get the semi-paid one. I can read it in and out. And so then it's like, okay, let's build out the back end. What have we got at the back end? So, you know, that's really where I'm, you know, I started looking at more information models, style businesses, but I really like consumable products because, you know, like an information business, someone's going to buy a piece of information one time. You know, if you've got a consumable product, people are going to buy that every single month. I like being in consumable products. You know, they swallow it. Every month they swallow it. You know, if you've got an information thing, like I know you're teaching people a guitar, right? Let's say you do online guitar lessons, right? They're only going to buy that one time, aren't you?
Yeah.
So yeah, the book is just a way to get it's a way to drive business. That's what a book is for anybody who's not a top novelist. It's a way to drive a business. The only thing is you need a really good back end. And a lot of people, they, you know, if you're thinking about structuring a media almost mini career or promotion, then you kind of think, well, what's her back end? And do you remember there was this black lady, she was extremely pretty, a former model, and she got really interested in baking, and her name's Lorraine Pascal, and the BBC picked her up and she did this baking show.
Vaguely, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I never watched TV. It's just my sister, like, she thought it was amazing. It's my sister that got me into Lorraine. I would have dated her. So the thing is, so, of course, right now, all right, a former model, right? So she's easy on the eye, right? That's a good thing, first thing. And the other thing is she could speak pretty good. She could communicate quite clearly. And then, you know, she was talking about something that people could relate to, putting food in the oven. So rather than something obscure, fly fishing. So, she did TV shows. But now I know I've also got a friend that she was a health presenter on Irish TV. And the thing is, if you look at, I mean, if you're a big name TV, I don't even know the big names are on TV anymore because I just never watch a freaking thing, and I'm not even in the country anymore. But you know, like I don't know, Graham Norton, for example, those guys are on a pretty decent income. Everybody else basically earns peanuts. They don't get paid that well from the TV program, right? So you know, I mean, I've looked at that because people said, oh man, your message is so good, get on TV. I'm like, you know, next thing you're hanging out with all these TV people. And so I've got a friend that's actually, she's a TV person in Ireland. You don't really make much money at that, right? So what's Jamie Oliver's model? He's got a whole team of people who are constantly brainstorming ideas to get him on TV. Not that he earns any money from the TV thing. He earns his money from all the other Jamie Oliver branded enterprises and books and everything else that comes from it.
Yeah.
The TV thing is just the advert for his brand.
Yeah.
So when you look at, you know, the radio's slightly different because you can get into longer conversations and they're a bit more encouraging for you to promote, you know, like you plug your stuff on radio, whereas you know, a lot of TV, they don't give you the, you know, short, mostly. But if you think, well, you know, it's okay. So the radio, the mass media thing, radio, TV, that's a way for you to promote your brand. What's your back end? Now, why is Jamie Oliver so much more wealthier than Gordon Ramsay? And Gordon Ramsay is not short of a pretty penny at all. But Jamie Oliver's just made a lot more money than him. And it's not because he's a better chef, because he's actually pretty bloody terrible as a chef in comparison to Gordon Ramsay. I mean, he doesn't have a single good restaurant. He sells absolute shit, and he hasn't got a single Michelin star. So he's not a particularly good chef, but he's an interesting guy to look at on TV and what he's done. And the reason why he's so much more wealthier than Gordon Ramsay is that he's got a really, really good, well thought out back end.
Yeah.
What happened with Lorraine Pascal is that she didn't have any back end. There was no back end. So she kind of thought, oh, well, this would be fun. I'll get on TV and I'll earn, like, I don't know, whatever, 50 grand a year for being on TV or whatever it was. I mean, it's peanuts, right? It's like, it's just TV doing that kind of gig is just like a good job income. That's it. And so then the BBC do what they do what they do. So, like, oh, we'll need a bit of a back end for our little presenters that are doing these shows. So we'll do the BBC book, and so they do the BBC published book, which was, you know, on Lorraine Pascal's breaking. Right, still no back end apart from the BBC book. All right, well, let's look at the book industry. What happens typically if you go down with a book publisher? Right, I know people that do books. By the if you run with a publisher, by the time all said and done, like, I got a friend, her book sell at $17.99. She gets about, I think, 65p of that. 65p. Right. So now let's look at it from the publisher's perspective. Right? They don't give a shit about your message. They don't give a shit about changing the world. What they care about is selling units. And they're conservative because most of the time they think it's not going to sell, right? I mean, like, the amount of time J.K. Rowling was turned down from book publishers. J.K., you know, children talking about witches and wizards. Nobody wants this bollocks. She got a lot of letters like that. It's quite funny if you read her story. So, you know, but if they kind of, like, got about half an inkling that, you know, maybe they'll spend a bit of money on you, they'll print 5,000 books.
Yeah. I get it. Yeah. You're doing your own book and you get to keep all the money and it's a brochure for the back end. You know, yeah. I get it.
But, I mean, like, the thing is, think about it, right? If they print 5,000 books, 2,000 of them don't sell, 3,000 of them do. And let's say you get £1 a book. You've sold 3,000 books, you've just earned £3,000. How long has it taken you to write that book?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so the thing is, just having a book is, it's a catalogue.
So what's your back end then?
You need a proper back end.
So what are you offering? Are you offering, like, presumably, like, coaching directly, nutritional advice for people? And what is it? And products?
The main thing I'm focused on is consumable products.
Okay, and what are they?
Yeah, we got really exciting ones. So we have one product, we call it the Max Vitality Mix, and so this is a product that does a lot of risk reduction for dementias. It improves people's brain power right now. Improves people's energy right now. It massively improves their blood flow, so, you know, people in sports are going to do well with it. It decreases people's risk of things like strokes and heart attacks. We have another product called Chocolate Merlin, which is our magical superfood herbal chocolate mix. I think mix it in with, like, a nut or seed milk. It tastes really good, and you can stick it with coffee as well. It's really nice.
So is this your own products? When you say we, who's we? Are you part of is this like a bigger
company? Yeah, it was, it's basically, it's, I run the business with my sister. It's my business, but my sister's just been an internal supporter and champion of what we do. So we do it together. And so she's in England looking after mail order and products whilst I'm driving business.
Okay.
And so,
produce it? How does it work?
Yeah. We manufacture the products ourselves, and so what we've done, where we're going now is going from this retarded model, which everybody does, which is just waiting and praying for somebody to make an order. Which is ridiculous because everybody does that, and all the big companies do that as well. The supermarkets do it, the petrol companies do it. Nowhere do they say, "Hey, you know what? You're buying petrol from us now. You're probably going to need petrol every single week until the end of time. You know, you're buying milk and bread and eggs from us now. from staying busy, you're probably going to need that every single week until the end of time. You know, let's set up some kind of a plan for that. So, you know, you get a lot of these business models where they're all doing the whole extremely reactive thing, hoping and praying someone's going to come in. And whereas it actually makes sense for consumable products to be on subscriptions. So, you know, like the milk service, you remember the milk service, you know, the milkman will turn up. Mm. Why? Because you need milk every bloody week, right? Just yeah. get it one time and then you're done for the next 10 years. You need it every week. So, and so that had a bit of a hiatus, that model, when the supermarkets came in and really replaced, you know, the milk float. But hey, it's back with us. It's back, you know, and people are realizing actually, you know, subscription consumables. And this is where, I mean, still hardly anybody's doing it, but there is a tiny, tiny, tiny little sliver of companies which are saying, we've got a consumable product, let's put it on subscription. And it's, you know, it takes a lot of stress out of doing business, because you're able to, you know, you're able to, you know, exactly what you got going in and out.
Are your products available?
Months in advance.
Is it available for purchase now?
Yeah. They're all available for purchase. So we've got a suite of products. That, as I say, the ones that people get excited about, I mean, we've got Mighty Mushroom Mix. That's a really good one. That's that reverses age-related immune system decline. So the chocolate Merlin, it's brilliant for your heart, brilliant for your brain, especially if you make it with a hemp seed milk, it just boosts your neurotransmitters. We've got a male formula one, Unleash the Beast Within. We've got some algae products, Algae Basic, Algae Mighty, with mixtures of some of the world's best algae. So we've got a green herbal product, we call it Emerald Merlin. What else is there? Various vitamin C products. I've got Almighty C, all made out of vitamin C, all made out of botanicals, and then orange C. And so, you know, and again, these are going into a direction where it's very different. It's further, you know, you want to try and do something that's the next thing, right? You're going to be, you know, the Americans say get rich in your niche. Well, you know, in the old days, I mean, like, you know, like if you go around all these health food stores in the UK, they all started from hippies back in the 60s and 70s, right? And I call them lentils and sandal stores, because, you know, you go in there and say, hey, you know, I'm on paleo. What have you got? got fucking nothing, because basically it's the healthy version of the Diabetics Anonymous shop, isn't it? That's basically what it is. It's organic diabetes. That's what they're selling.
Right.
Right? How is it a health shop is selling organic diabetes?
You mean it's sugar and carbs, but it's expensive sugar and carbs?
Yeah, you know, well, I mean, okay, so I mean, I'll just take the piss out myself on this one. But when I started understanding that wheat wasn't very good for human beings, and it fucks us up in many, many ways, even if you're not gluten intolerant, and I've never been gluten intolerant, but it's just a difficult food for us. Not a food that's for human beings at all. And so I went into the Lentils and Sandals hippie health shop, and I started making friends with all the other grains, didn't I? I mean, your amaranth and your spelt and your barley and your buckwheat and all that bollocks. And when I got a bit clever about it and learned that you got to read, it's all 80% carbohydrates. If you put a carbohydrate, I really like what the late Charles Poulikin said when he said that you've got to deserve your carbohydrates. If you can't see all six lines of your abs, no carbs for the next 6 months.
Right.
Right. If you still can't see all six lines of your abs after 6 months, you can have 10 licks of a dried prune once a month and still no carbs for the following 6 months. You know, so, well, the thing is, it doesn't, if you've got organic carbohydrates or non-organic carbohydrates or carbohydrates coming from fruit or wherever the bloody hell they're coming from, if you jack up your blood glucose, I try and put that in the most simple to understand terms possible. Elevated blood glucose is, I call it rotting disease. How do you make alcohol? You get a barrel of water, and you put sugar in there, you cap it off and you leave it. That's how you make alcohol, right?
Yeah.
Rum, for example, vodka, for example, right? So you're fermenting sugar in water, whether it be a grain-based alcohol like a beer or a vodka or, you know, one from cane, which is rum, or grape juice, which is wine or whatever, it's sugar in water. It's carbohydrates in water. Well, your body is 70% water. You put carbohydrates in there and you elevate your blood glucose above 4.4 millimoles, fasting blood glucose, you're going to rot your body. I call it rotting disease, just to make it easy, because you can got all these stupid names that the medical industry and the universities give rotting disease. But it's all rotting disease, whether you talk about Alzheimer's, whether you talk about a glaucoma, whether you talk about cataracts, whether you talk about gum disease, whether you talk about diabetes, whether you talk about heart disease, whether you talk about cancer, Alzheimer's, what else is there? Irritable bowel, what else? And then you've got the all the infectious stuff, which is all driven by elevated glucose. Not to mention wrinkly skin, which is driven by, you know, if people got elevated blood glucose. There was a woman who was a plastic surgeon. She actually did a TV show on British TV. She said that she got a bunch of people, found out their blood glucose, took a bunch of pictures of them, showed them to everyone else. Guess what? People who had the highest blood glucose levels, their skin looked a lot more wrinkly for their age compared to the people that had lower blood glucose levels. So basically, you rot your body. You turn yourself into your own little micro distillery fermentation factory, right? Because you've got elevated blood glucose. Your body couldn't give a shit whether that glucose is coming from a mango or a Mars bar, or an organic amaranth black rice grain grown on the top of the mountain by the Dalai Lama. It's all glucose. The whole lot turns into glucose. And so elevated glucose.
Are you saying elevated glucose is the source of all disease? It sounds like what you're saying.
It's not that simple, Ben. I mean, I'd love it to be that simple, but it's the cause of a tremendous amount of it. Okay. And inflammation as well, inflammatory-based situations. I mean, disease is, when somebody says cure for all disease, that's bollocks. There is no single cure for all disease. But there are some rather large driving factors behind why the body fucks up. Elevated glucose is a very important, factor. Anything that's going to elevate your blood glucose above 4.4 when you wake up in the morning, or 6.7 an hour after eating a meal, is a problem. You're going to get fat on the top of that.
Let me ask you a question. I was listening to Jordan Peterson, and he just eats beef.
Great.
And he claims that it improved a lot of the ailments that he had. What's your view of that?
Well, first off, I don't know Jordan Peterson. Never heard of him. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. Typically, I mean, if you go into a bookshop, you're going to come across 500 different diets, right? They can't all be right, can they? Right? If there's 500 different dietary ideas out there, clearly the vast majority of it's got to be complete bullshit, right? The reason why all these different dietary ideas have anecdotal success, not big study success, but anecdotal success. The reason why they all have anecdotal success, every single one of these 500 different diets, they all have anecdotal success stories. And the reason why is because not one of those diets is recommending someone to eat food which is as bad as what people are currently eating in Great Britain.
Right, so it's cutting out the shit that has the most of the benefit and effect, and then the rest of the fine details, you know, are sort of...
No matter what diet, every single diet, no matter how terrible it is, it's still of a heck of a lot better than what people are doing.
Yeah.
The Great Britain obesity problem, right? So the thing is, here's how I put things into perspective.
Would you eat just beef?
I wouldn't.
Okay.
And I'll tell you why, because this is, again, if you look at the science, I love reading science. If you look at the science, you find that there's a lot of heart disease associated with red meat consumption. A lot of heart disease. Now, Charles Poulikin, what he said is that that's only for this animals who are eating shit, you know, factory farmed animals eating genetically modified soybeans. And then he died of a heart attack. At what, 57? So, you know, I'm not so much, you know, wild yak didn't seem to work for him.
Well, I don't know if a study's been done on people that just eat beef, though. So, I mean, has it? I don't think so. I mean, I don't know.
You know, there is so much studies done on red meat consumption. I think if you want to look at the work of Walter Willett, okay, Dr. Walter Willett from Loma Linda University, California, okay? So what's interesting about Loma Linda University? Are you recording this, Ben? Because we're going on for quite a while here.
Yeah, recording.
Oh, man. Okay, because we didn't even say, hey, we're going to start recording now. All right, yeah, edit out the good bits. All right, first off, let's backtrack a step. So we found out that, you know, these extremely long-lived people from Vilcabambia and, you know, the various far-flung places, we found out that none of that was true. And what we did actually find from demographics and science is that there is a place on the planet where people are living a really, really, really long time, and it's called the island of Okinawa, which is, it used to be a separate kingdom from Japan, but now it's part of Japan, but it's way south of most of the Japanese islands. It's really, 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 it's sort of halfway in between Japan and the Philippines. And there, they have the world's longest lived people. If you want to be a centenarian, go to Okinawa and do what the Okinawan elders are doing, and that's your number one chance of becoming a centenarian. And so then the two researchers that went out there to study that was my friends. That was two twin brothers, Craig and Bradley Wilcox. So they took over the Okinawa study and to find out what are these people doing that is causing them to live extraordinarily long, healthy lives. I'll give you an example, right? So we talked earlier about dementia. One out of three people track to get dementia in Great Britain right now, right? Stats are going to be the same in America because we eat the same shit as them. Okinawans only get half the amount of dementias compared to the Yankees and the mainland Japanese. So what are they doing on Okinawa to have only half the amount of dementias, okay? It's kind of interesting. So Craig and his brother Bradley, they've been studying that, and then a journalist who was working with National Geographic, he got the idea that maybe he'd work with a bunch of other demographers and find out if there's anybody else on the planet who was living a long time, and he identified four other places in addition to Okinawa, and one of them was Loma Linda, California, and he found out that people in Loma Linda, California, they're exposed to the same amount of political bullshit as the rest of the Americans. They're exposed to the same advertising messages from Coca-Cola or McDonald's as the rest of the Americans. They have the exact same health care as the rest of the Americans, and they have the same drug system as the rest of the Americans, but they live 8 years longer.
Okay.
And this is, it's just a little place which is just outside of LA. I mean, it's literally just outside of LA. So it's like, well, hang on a minute. So what's different in Loma Linda? Well, what's different in Loma Linda is they have the Church of Seventh-day Adventists.
What's that?
Seventh-day Adventist is a Christian sect. And a big drive in their sect is that, first off, they really, you know, when the Bible says your diet shall be herb with seed and fruit with seed, they really take that to heart. Genesis 1:29, right? 29th sentence in the Bible.
So what do they eat? They
eat a vegetarian diet.
Okay.
They don't eat meat. Now, so they live 8 years longer than the average American just because they don't eat meat. Now, what happened is that Dr. Walter Willett, at a local university who's been studying this group. I mean, it's been going on for decades now to study. And he found out that, I mean, now the thing is they eat a lot of shit, but they don't eat meat. I mean, now that they get, I mean, there's stuff that I wouldn't eat. They eat pretty much the same shit as the rest of the Americans. It's just that they got, you know, soybeans and they turn it into, I don't know, stuff that looks like bacon rashers, for example, right?
So they still eat shit, but they just cut out the meat, and you're saying they still live longer.
Yeah. They eat a lot of, you know what? I don't know if you've... You know, this has been this movement in food industry is that people, you know, they still want to eat badly. So some people, food manufacturers come out with like the healthy version of bad food, don't they? Now this is the healthy sausage, you know.
So. I'm confused. So they're still eating the bullshit, but they've cut out the animal meat, but they're still living longer.
That's right.
Okay, that seems counterintuitive.
And anyway, so Walter Willett has done studies on this group. And he says, well, the thing is, because now I've actually been a guest health minister at the church in London, actually, at the Seventh-day Adventist church, because they have, it's a lot of fun because it's a gospel church, and they have a guest health minister. So I was guest health minister speaking about health, and health is one of the things that they talk about within the church. And you kind of think, actually, this is actually, it's like a really good, fun personal development group, Ben. Mm. I mean, it's like, if it wasn't, you know, under the, in a church building, you think, man, this is a great place. I'd love to go anyway. It's just that, you know, some people got beliefs about religion which should prevent them from going. But I thought, wow, this is fantastic. And anyway, so Walter Willett found out that some of these Seventh-day Adventists, they sneak down a bit of meat when nobody's looking.
Right. Now I'm more confused.
Yeah, they found that some of them sneaked down a bit of meat when nobody's looking.
Hang on, wait, hold on a second.
I'll tell you something. Oh. So Walter Willett, he's been tracking these people over decades, finding out who are the ones that actually don't eat any meat at all, and who are the ones that sneak down a little bit of meat when nobody's looking. And he found that even the tiniest... I mean, in America, they use the ounce system still. So they find that it's basically like a little 3-ounce piece of meat, which is the size of a deck of playing cards, right? If you've been to USA, you can't get food that small, right? No one's going to serve you food that small. He found that even if you eat a little bit of meat like that once a week, dramatically shoots up your chances of getting heart attacks and strokes. Now, what I did is I used a device called an arteriograph to find out people's level of arterial stiffness, because that's a pretty good gauge of arteriosclerosis, okay? I would love to make it more available, because the number one thing that people are dying from in the West is heart attacks and strokes, and then not just that, but you've got erectile dysfunction and thrombosis, and it's all a blood flow disorder, and arteriosclerosis is behind it. Mostly it's behind it. There's other factors as well, but arteriosclerosis is a big one. One thing for sure, it's you don't want to have your pipes furred up, almost like, you know, calcium pipes. So, and I found that the people that are exposed to the most amount of meat consumption, they have the hardest blood vessels. The people, you know, I've had 30-year-olds who I've been testing, plenty of meat consumption, crazy hard blood vessels. I've had 60-year-olds, and they've been vegan 60 years or 40 years of that, really soft blood vessels. And so the thing is, you want your blood vessels to be soft. And so when I backtrack it a little bit, and I'll give you one of my big picture ideas here, Ben, but let's backtrack it a bit. The most successful people, companies, organizations and countries are the ones which have the longest term time frame of reference. If you think success, or if you think happiness, and you think, all right, well, you know, I really want to be happy today. All right, well, what could I do to make myself happy? Well, I could have an ice cream, and I could have some recreational drugs, and I could have a bottle of champagne, and I'll get a hooker. Right? I'll have a really happy day, right? No doubt you could do. However, how sustainable is that? Right? So the someone, you know, like, I don't know, like, I know, the drunkard, right? Someone scrounging up money on the street corner saying, oh, can you lend me some money? And then the next thing you know, they're in the off-license buying beer with the money you just given them. So they've got a goal, right? People used to say, well, you need a goal. Well, they've got goals. Their goal is to get another bottle of wine. They've got a goal. But they've got a short time. They've got a short time frame. They are not thinking much more than the next, you know, few hours. The people that are the most successful are thinking about the longest time frames, you know, 100 years, 200 years, 300 years. So I asked myself the question, could I do what this person is proposing for 100 years and never have a problem?
What do you mean? Like lifestyle and nutrition, you mean?
Anything. If someone's coming up with some wild and crazy idea, could you do it for 100 years and never have a problem? All right, let's talk about a well-thought-out exercise program. Could you do it for 100 years and never have a problem? Absolutely. Absolutely, and it's actually one of those things that would cause you to live to 100 years. Okay, meditation. Could you do it for 100 years and never have a problem? Absolutely. Lettuce. Could you eat lettuce every single day for 100 years and never have a problem? Damn right. What about cigarette smoking? Probably not. You know, so the thing is, the ideas which seem like a good idea in the short term, they're not always that great against a longer time frame perspective. Red meat's one of them. Now, there's a lot of benefits in the field of performance, especially for athletes, and red meat consumption. You know, there's some things going on in red meat, but you can get those things that are going on in red meat from other sources that are safer. That's what I'm petitioning for. So yes, you can have, you can. It's like how long do you want to shine for? Yeah. If you just want to shine for the next 10, 15 years, well, do whatever you're going to do. If you're thinking about living a bit longer than that,
yeah.
Then sustainability.
Yeah,
comes to the fore. I was just looking at. I don't know if you. I mean, you're quite a strong guy, Ben, so you must be aware of professional bodybuilding in its history. But I was looking at an interview with Ronnie Coleman. Do you know Ronnie Coleman?
Yeah, I do. I'm familiar. Yeah, I follow the sport.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, Ronnie Coleman. Well, you know what's going to happen to Ronnie. So just for your listeners, so Ronnie Coleman, he was, I think, Mr. Olympia for 8 years in the trot. So he won the world's number one bodybuilding title for 8 years in a row. He had an incredible physique. I mean, pleasing on the eye, crazy muscular. I mean, it was amazing. Thing is, for you to be that muscular, you have to lift really, really heavy weights, right? You can't be crazy muscular. I mean, what was he weighing? It's like 150 kilograms or something like that.
Yeah,
at 2% body fat, something insane. I mean, I don't know the exact figures, but it's something like that. And now he's got a whole bunch of spinal disc injuries where he's hobbling around on crutches.
Well, yeah, he's a crazy powerlifter, though. I mean, I don't know what's.
So the story I was looking at, and you know, I'm not going to get into this because I never met Ronnie, and actually, I have met Ronnie one time. I did meet Ronnie Coleman one time, but you know, the thing is, I'm not part of that. All I'm saying is, the story I was looking at, the story was, the dialogue was, a tremendous amount of extremely heavy weights, deadlifts and squats for many, many, many years. They had a toll that had to be paid by his discs.
Yeah.
And that's part of his problem now, right?
Yeah.
Or like, you look at Dorian Yates. He can't lift weights anymore because the amount of injuries he sustained from being that muscular and that big and that strong, right? Yeah. So the thing is it possible to do something in the short term that's going to give you incredible results? Yeah, Dorian Yates, Ronnie Coleman put on an incredible amount of muscle, and Dorian was 6 times Mr. Olympia. Ronnie Coleman was 8 times Mr. Olympia. You know, top guys in their respective sports. To be at the top of any sport is unbelievably difficult for anybody, right? These are the top guys from absolutely years. They dominated it. Was it sustainable? Not anymore. right?
Yeah.
So the thing is, what I'm saying is that there are many examples where something can be, it can have benefits in the short term, but not be such a good idea in the long term.
Yeah, I get it. Right? Yeah, I get it.
Red meat is great for explosive power. If you're in any kind of a strength sport, it's great, right? It's hard to be, I mean, according to Charles Poliquin, he said that he's never seen anybody involved in any sport that required a bit of power that was a vegan. Yeah, they just can't do it. Okay, yeah. endurance running, okay. But no, if you need some power, you got to get some flesh foods now. Now, I've choose seafoods. That's where we've gone in the longevity movement. We think that seafoods are safe. I think there's a range of reasons why that could be true. That's where I'm going with it. I might be wrong, but I've got a bunch of rationale behind that. And there's a lot of people that agree with me, hardcore science guys. And I'm going to tell you something, when I go to a health science conference, I mean, you know, that there's consensus in the camp. There's a lot of extremely bright, well-read science guys out there, and nobody takes anybody's word for nothing, right? Somebody comes up with an idea, they scrutinize that idea upside and down, and they consider it, and they still call it bollocks if that's what they feel. You know, so the thing is, and what's interesting is...
Peter, just stop a second. I feel like you haven't given me a word in edgeways. You've talked for almost 2 hours without even taking a breath, and it's getting a bit tiring. So I'm going to wrap up the call.
Right.
You've got some interesting stuff. You take a long time to say anything. You ramble and ramble. And and so I've had enough of it. So have a nice day and all the best.